down.
Hi.
Hi, Tom.
Hi. Grab a seat there, put you in the hot seat. Well, welcome, your last interview, and.
Happy for you.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for your willingness to apply for the position, it means a lot, I think, to have people interested. What we're gonna do is ask about 10 questions.
Okay.
Some of us, you know, may have a follow-up or clarification to some of them, but it's the same questions that obviously we're asking all of the four applicants for the position. Try to, you know, be relaxed, I mean.
Sure.
It's not the best setting, but, you know most of it, I guess you hadn't met Jan before, she mentioned you didn't admit, but.
Now I remember you from being a kid now.
From a kid, but be relaxed. So.
Well, I appreciate you, the opportunity, and I appreciate the time, so I appreciate that.
And we kind of rotated questions, so you're stuck with me asking you the first question, and we'll go around the table this way.
All right.
We'll just kinda ask you a series of questions, and again, you know, just take your time to answer them.
Sure.
And we try to do the interview in about 25 to 30 minutes, so Bob ran a little bit long, as you know, you were waiting out there. Why are you interested in elective office, and what kinda drew you for, you know, to apply for the position?
There are a few reasons. The first is very selfish, and that is because I live here, and I want this community to do well, and to be well, because it's my community, and if it's doing well, that means that the quality of my life is better. So that's the selfish reason. Second reason is just pride. I've always been kind of a loyal and proud person, and I grew up in North St. Paul, and after living away for some years, came back here, and I'm raising my family here, so I have a lot of pride in this place. Graduated from North High School, along with my 9 brothers and sisters, and
Is that how many were in that?
All 10 of us.
I knew it was about Sonnek.
Yeah.
I knew there were a lot of you guys, but.
Yeah, so it's about time one of us got it. I feel that North St. Paul pride that I think a lot of people do. You sense that out and around, people who talk about the car show, people, you see it on the different Facebook pages in the North St. Paul communities. People are very proud of this place, and I think, you know, a lot of times, I was just talking to Scott Dudek about this, a lot of times there's this angst about what 7th Avenue used to be when we were growing up then. And it's tough, because we'll never see those days again. There won't be a Kendall's and another shoot and all those down there, just probably not gonna happen. But at the same time, I think that really demonstrates the pride that other people have in the community, and the memory of growing up here. North St. Paul is a pretty unique suburb, and it's hard to even really call it a suburb because it's such a unique city in and of itself. It wasn't something that just sprouted up to build a bunch of housing developments, you know, this was a city in and of itself. And I think people like that. And then the third reason is that I've just always had some interest in being involved in elected office, and even though this is not an election, but volunteering for the community, so those are the three reasons.
Well, thank you. Terry's got the next one.
What is an area of interest in the local, in the local municipal government, and why? What is an area of interest?
That's not a good question.
We all struggle with it. That is a bad question.
What is an area of interest in local municipal government, and why?
That you have in life.
Yes, well, and I can refer to your strategic plan here, which I think is really well done. I look at, so your 6 major themes and vision statements here. So there's community engagement and communication, which I think is really important. Residential character and neighborhoods, which I also think is very important. I'm very interested in that. Business and economic, we know what that is. I don't see that as my strong suit in the business and economic development area. Although I've worked in corporate environment for a long time, developing small businesses is probably not my strong suit. That's not my interest in getting involved. Transportation, operations and services. I've been involved in operations for a number of years now in different business ventures and corporations, and So I have a lot of interest in that area, just running, helping things run more smoothly, creating as much value for the customer or the citizen as we can. So my background in business is quality assurance, customer service, and it really comes down to there are two types of processes, those that add value for the customer and those that don't. And so I think for me too, when I look at being involved in elected office, I'm very interested in where the money is going and why. It's my money too, and it's a value. What adds value to me as a customer, as a citizen? So I think those are those things that every government body has to focus on, every business has to focus on, is what we're doing offering value to the customer? And if it's not, why are we doing it? So those are the things that I really have interest in. So those operational areas, I'm also very interested in, you know, just the neighborhood community development. It's important for me, you know, like I said, I take a lot of pride in this town, and it pains me when I see pride not being shown or taken in other areas of the city, you know. So so it's important, and that I served for a brief time, but I think 9 years ago on a small commission
neighborhood stability task force,
and you know, so those things are important to me. I see that every day. Everybody sees it every day. It's important.
Okay, Tom, what three challenges do you see facing the city council other than the budget or financial?
Number one has got to be, even though I just said it's not my strong suit, it's the business and economic development part. I think that's got to be your biggest challenge. That's the thing I hear about a lot. Is what are they going to do about that? I don't think people look at the city council and say, you have to bring businesses and you have to bring 7th Avenue back to what it was in 1973 or something like that. But I think that's something that people think about a lot. So I think that's one of the challenges, is somehow deciding how, what does sustaining 7th Avenue look like, and what does developing 7th Avenue look like, and how does that get communicated to the citizenry? So I think that brings me to the second point, is the communication with the citizenry. I think there's a challenge there, but it's the number one challenge for any group. The number one complaint you'll get from the people that you are working with or for in any organization will say communication. So, and it will be your number one, and I'm sure it is one of your.
Comes up all the time.
Yeah. I never heard about this. Why didn't anybody tell me about this? And it's probably been sent to them, and you know, announced in a loudspeaker, drive down the streets. You know, you're just not going to give to everybody. There's some responsibility that every citizen has to take as well in order to educate themselves. So that communication, that's your first vision theme here, community engagement and communication. I think that's a real challenge. But I think we're also in a place in time where there are greater opportunities than there ever have been. And you walk around and everybody has their phone in their hand, and they're doing unbelievable things with phones now. You know, I ride the bus to work every day and was stressing out over, I didn't have enough time to buy my daughter a birthday present on time. And I thought, well, when am I going to sit down at the computer and do this? And I thought, well, I have a computer in my pocket. So I went to Amazon on my computer in my pocket, and I ordered my daughter a birthday present right there. So
a droid didn't bring it over there.
Yeah, and then there's a drone dropper there. So those are the types of things. I think, I don't know what's already in the works there, but I think there are great opportunities there to help communicate with the community. But I think North St. Paul does a lot. I mean, the website that we have is fabulous. It's really well done, well designed. The newsletter, although I'm still adjusting to the change in the format, but the newsletter with the monthly bill, I read it every month. I like that. You know, so those are good ways to communicate, but I think that's the challenge. You know, what is the direction of the city? Where are we trying to go? What should people expect? And what do they have problems with? How do we get their voice? How do you get that voice of the customer, the voice of the citizen? And and try and understand where the real problems are. The third, was there three things you wanted?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would, there are just, you know, something that I hear, this is, I don't know if this is just a vicious rumor, but I keep hearing people say the city council is going to get rid of the car show on Fridays.
Oh.
Again, goes back to that communication thing, yeah. So, but I think that's part of the communication. I think the other big challenge is the residential blight. I think it is maintaining those communities, our community, all these pockets as best we can. It's a challenge. It's, I think, a case-by-case challenge to deal with these residences. But those things make a difference, especially if you're driving on a main road that comes into our town and you see a house that's running apart, falling apart, or you're wondering what might be going on in that house, that's a problem. And then when there are real things that are going on in a house, when a house gets shut down and boarded up because there's some illegal activity going on, those are the things that are, I think, can really bring down the pride, the sense of pride in the community really quickly. And anything that we can do to address those things, it's, you know, these things, they're just, everything feeds into each other. So, I mean, if you start to make the residential areas more desirable, well, then the property values go up. And if the property values go up, then there's more money coming in. And then if there's more money coming in, then the you know, what does that do to the school district? And what does that do to the school? And then the school ratings go up because, you know, now all of a sudden everything's building and feeding into each other. And that sounds easy, but, but you know, as a city council, I think that that's something that can be and is addressed. Should continue to be.
All right, well, you just gave us three challenges. What do you see as three goals other than the budget or financial? Three goals or areas for us to focus on?
I'll start by saying I think there are a lot of things that we're doing well. I think the maintenance of the parks, I think a lot of the shared city areas, that the way that they're maintained, some of this by volunteer groups, some of it by, I'm sure, Parks and Recreation Committee or Commission, but our parks are looking good. I know that there has been some volunteer effort, but that's, you know, I think the city's been involved in some of those things. So, you know, the way that we manage things, making things more available online, the e-commerce area that you talked about in the operations and services vision that you have there, that's really well done. I think our utilities are well done. And I think that the utilities, being unique as they are for North St. Paul, that we have our own, I think that's an area that maybe needs to be protected and expanded. I don't know where we stand right now with our water, but I know a lot of people would be very unhappy to lose our water just to fill up White Bear Lake. One of my brothers has traveled the world a lot, and he said, there's two good waters in the world. One's out of Italy and one's north of Paul. So I think, again, it kind of gets to that sense of pride there. So I think in those utilities, the windmill, what does that mean? I mean, it's a great symbol to see as you drive into our town, but what does it mean for us? What is it doing for us as a city? And how are we seeing any benefit from that? And if we are seeing benefit from it, then why don't we do more of it? I know there's mention in the plan here of expanding solar and, you know, different opportunities there. So I think that's one good goal. I think another big goal, and it's something that I noticed was noticeably missing in the strategic plan, was really any specific mention of Silver Lake. I think that is one of our biggest natural resources, you know, and what a great resource it is for the city. And how are we taking care of that? How are we, and I don't want to, this word sounds wrong, but I don't want to, about how do we exploit, and I mean exploit it by using the beauty of it and what it is and care for it and maintain those parks. Everybody misses the curly slide. But, you know, how do we, to me, it's North St. Paul is downtown on one end and Silver Lake on the other end. Maybe that's because I live in the middle of them, but I have Casey Lake on the other end. I grew up on Casey Lake first. But those, and Casey Lake too, you know, these are natural resources that we have. And I think helping those resources shine a little bit is another big one. And just personally, I'm also curious about the community center and if that's gone for good or where we go with that. And if there's, do we, is that something that we replace with other promoting healthy lifestyles through other ways, trails, that kind of thing? Or is it that the community center is something that is actually could be used and expanded upon and be really a center for the community? I don't know. That's kind of personal thoughts on that, but to me, that's
we don't have the answers here.
Yes,
we need to work on it.
Would like to take a break. I think Jen needs to.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, that's okay. Right. I could just tell she was struggling. She has a cold. You doing better, kiddo?
I'm so sorry. That's okay.
Oh,
okay.
We said nothing worse than about trying not to cough when you have.
You got some water? So do you want to try and get some?
Yeah.
So you got some?
I got more.
Okay. Cool. Just so you have some.
Keep the liquids
dry. Yeah, they're throwing me for a
she's got an arsenal.
Refrigerator down there.
Oh, no.
She's okay. Ready to roll? Well, moving on with our next question.
I've started along. Yeah.
No, you're fine. You're doing
no,
fine.
We'll just keep you till midnight.
Yeah. No, we were over with Bob.
It's the next question, which after this, we're halfway through.
I'll just answer yes or no.
Part of it, you could. Have you read the city strategic plan, as you refer to it? But what did you take away from it, and how do you think you can help us achieve those strategies and objectives in it?
Okay, good, yeah. Well, first of all, like I said, I think it's really well done. Secondly, you have 6 vision and themes. You have 23 strategies and 88 objectives. That's a lot. Granted, it is a 5-year plan, so that breaks down to 17.6 objectives that you have to get through each year if you want to stay on pace, or 8.8 every 6 months. I tend to work on a 6-month tactical plan with my work, but
The numbers guy here.
Yeah, so I do get into data a little bit. I don't know why. It doesn't seem like it's my background, but the reality is there's a lot there. There are some things that are. And I mean, nothing's really low-hanging fruit. I mean, some things are easier than others, like business and economic development is a little more challenging than sharing the information with the staff that work at City. So, but it's good. It's a good comprehensive plan. There are some things that I wondered about as I went through that I thought were maybe missing, particularly relationship with public safety, with fire and police, and how that works into all this. It's good, and this is a starting point. So now you say, okay, now we're going to take each one of these things and say, well, how do we now do problem solving around this? And so that's my question: is how are you? You know how to eat an elephant is one bite at a time. So how are you taking this into smaller bites and working with it? Because you can't do all of it at once. And so how does that break down? And then where do you break it down from there? So say if you were to take 8.8 of these objectives in a 6-month time frame and say, well, we want to try and work through these things, then how does the formal problem solving happen? what measurements are you using to know if you're making progress? And so for me, that's the big thing, are the measures to say, and then this links back then to the communication to the community, is that, you know, this is our strategic plan. You may never read it, but here are some of the things that we're trying to do in it. And here's what we've been doing in this past year, and here's how we've done. You know, here's the work that we've been involved in, and here are the problems that we're trying to solve, and here's what difference we're seeing, if any. And how are we moving the dial on all those things? And I think those things are important. And I think that, if it's communicated to the community in an effective narrative, they'll appreciate it. If they can see what you're doing and see how much of a difference it's made without just being in an Excel spreadsheet kind of table format or something like that, I think there's an opportunity to get the city on board, to get the citizens on board to understand what's happening and where you're going. I'm not sure if I answered the question.
Yeah, no, I think you did. Part of it was how you'd help us achieve this, and I think...
And I think that's part of it, because this is a lot of my background is doing this kind of thing. So as soon as I got into this, I said, yep, okay, I recognize the structure. I do it a little bit differently, but then here's where we go from there. And when it comes to that, I have a lot of background in formal problem solving, analytics. I like to get into that and understand, really what the real problem is. What's the root cause? What are the effects of the problem? And where do we want to go? What do we want the future state to look like? And if that's what we want it to look like, how are we going to get there? And how will we know how we're doing along the way? So that's some of my background to help.
Thank you.
Okay, Tom. What is your best attribute or strength that you bring to the position?
I don't take things too seriously. I think my strengths are in responsibility and analytics. I've always liked to have the ball. You know, I like to be involved. But that said, another one of my strengths is harmony. I like to keep harmony within a group. I like to seek consensus. I like to bring everybody together all along. To me, we don't win unless everybody wins. It's not about me. It's about the objective. And so I really take the time to step back, understand what the problem is, understand what the goal is, so to know that we're going the right way, and try and make sure that everybody's on board and moving along with it. So it's that moving a whole team forward. Despite all this talk about analytics and all that stuff, my background is in theater. I have been an actor all my life, but also was the founder and artistic director of a theater company. And that's, to me, I relate a lot back to that. It's a great discipline. And if you're directing a play, it's about everybody doing well in tune with what the objective of the playwright is. It's about the story.
Let me ask you, what's the challenge or your weakness that you might bring?
I think what my weakness over time I've seen is that, I feel like I get something done, and so I'm ready to move on. I want to move on to the next thing. But you've got to make sure that you sustain the progress that you made somewhere else. You know, so I think sustaining progress from previous problem solving is one of the things that's a little more challenging for me. But that's where I feel these metrics and data can really help, because then once you establish that, then you'll see how it's going, and you can see visually that you're maintaining it or not. And so if it starts to nosedive, that's your wake up call that says, hey, you've got to take care of this. So that's kind of, to me, that's been a challenge over time. It's just kind of trying to trying to sustain some of those past achievements.
Okay. If someone were to describe to us your leadership style, what would they describe it? How would they describe it?
Hands off.
Hands off.
Yeah, okay. I'm more of a facilitative leader. I don't like it when people are too directive with me and they micromanage, and I don't want to be that with anybody else either. And my expectation is, for myself, is to be as clear as possible with what the objectives are and where we want to go, and then have good people that do that. And so, you know, I check and adjust with those people to make sure it's happening, or if it's not happening, then we make corrections to keep it going in the right direction. But I like to work with good people and let them do their thing.
Okay. Hey. Oh, it's my turn. Council members have to make tough decisions that are often disagreeable to the and to and emotional for citizens. How will you balance making the right decision knowing you might not make friends in the process?
Well, again, I think, Jan, it's really focusing on that overall objective, and I think that's what you have to do all the time. And it's funny because even just this morning I had to have a tough conversation with an employee that works for me. She just got back from a leave of absence. She's had a baby, and it's been a struggle for her to come downtown every day and have that much time away from her baby. So she asked for a flexible work schedule. And there are some areas in my work where that'll work, but not mine. And so it was tough to have to bring that news back to her that I just couldn't do it with it, to offer that flexible work schedule based on our business days. Mm-hmm. So, but that's, it's not a decision I felt that I was making, it was a decision that the business was making. And so I think that's really what we have to look at with the citizens. It's like, this is what's best for the city. And so there'll always be those hard decisions, tough calls, but I think if you're focusing on the right objective, that at least makes it feel better. I mean, you might make mistakes, but hopefully if you're better 50-50, you're doing all right.
And if you're above 50, it's probably pretty good.
51-49 years.
Yeah.
Fortunately, we have some, but not an overabundance. Well, my last question, and this is the second to the last question, my last one is, do you understand, I mean, from a council perspective, it's commitment is more than like preparing an attendee, the two meetings that, you know, we also have other liaison things we work on.
Right.
And how do you see this commitment fitting into your home life, and are you willing to participate as a council member by attending the community events in the city?
Yeah. Well, I think I'm trying to weigh that out with my involvement in the Cub Scouts right now. I had done some baseball coaching and that kind of thing, but I think it will. My kids are getting older, so I think it's easier for me to handle that time away. I do still, or at least have, continued to do some acting from time to time, which takes up a lot of time as well. So I was able to balance that with home life as well. So I think it's doable. I think how much of a commitment it is has yet to be seen. If that's something that may have to drop me down the ranks of the Cub Scouting world, and that might be something I'll have to consider as well.
Terry has the last one.
Why should you be appointed to the city council?
I don't know.
It is.
I think because of some of the strengths that I bring, I have. I'm willing to back things up if needed. I'm willing to say we need to go slow to go fast. I'm willing to say we don't have the problem right yet. We can't make the decision. I'm willing to just let my voice be heard. I think Colin Powell has a great quote about loyalty. He said, loyalty is disagreeing strongly and executing faithfully. And I think that works well in the political world too. It's not loyalty to the mayor or loyalty to you or anybody else. It's loyal to the purpose. And I think when you're loyal to the purpose, that means that you are willing to make your voice be heard, even if it's not comfortable or if it's controversial, that you're willing to speak up. I'm happy to debate. I think it's fun. But at the same time, if a decision is made and this is the decision that we're moving forward with, now we're in implementation time. So the decision's done and now you execute faithfully. And so that's important to the purpose of taking care of the city. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about taking care of the city.
As we wrap up, Jan has a follow-up.
I have a question. Why have you not ever run for council?
Well, I've thought about it a lot. And I think part of it is since I've come home, a lot of the challenge has just been raising little babies and trying to, you know, make a house work and that kind of thing. So I've just been really involved that way. But it's always something that I've been looking at, always something that I've been interested in. And with this situation, it just seemed to be an opening that I should try and give a shot.
Anything else you want to add, Tom, before you wrap up? It's up to you. Or any questions or anything?
I just want to say I appreciate the opportunity and the time, and I think that there are a lot of great things about the city. There are a lot of great things about the direction the city is going. This is really good. The strategic plan is good, and I think a lot of things that we're doing are look good and make the city look good. So if I'm chosen, I hope I can add.
Appreciate that. Well, thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.
You can give up.
Thanks
again.
Yep, take care.
You do anything with the Venture Connection anymore?
Yeah, a little bit.
Do you?
Mm-hmm. You got kids over there?
Well, Jack is there still. He's just finishing third grade tomorrow.
No, I don't need that. Okay.
Yeah, Ruby. Yeah,
yeah. There you go.
Well, thank you again.
Take care of you.
Yeah.